Great. Next, there are two things left that we need to look at to ensure that dynamic programming makes sense in the contexts where we're going to want to use it. First, we're going to look at what are called Blackwell's sufficient conditions for a contraction mapping. And what that's going to do is that it's going to help us tell very quickly when we write down a mathematical problem whether or not the contraction mapping theorem is going to apply to it, and thus whether or not we can write down a meaningful value function for that problem. The second thing we need to do is extend these methods to problems where functions are not necessarily bounded. So for example, consider a production function of the following form. F of k such that output equals, let's say, some constant times capital to the power alpha, where alpha is between 0 and 1. That production function, of course, is not bounded. If you increase capital, it goes on to infinity. Alternatively, preferences could also be unbounded. So consider the following instantaneous utility function, u of c equals consumption to this power over that power. Now, this utility function is one that macroeconomists use a lot. It displays constant relative risk aversion, which means that u double prime over u prime is a constant. And if you're wondering why this minus one is here, it's because the limit of this function as sigma tends to one equals the natural log of c. You can show that as an exercise. If the minus one were not here, however, then that wouldn't be true. You can see because if sigma goes to one, then the bottom goes to zero. As sigma goes to one, then this goes to unity. So we have 1 minus 1 over 1 minus 1, which tells us we can apply L'Hopital's rule here and then take the appropriate derivatives to try and see what this converges to. In any case, the point right now is that just like this production function is not bounded, this utility function is not bounded either. So let's begin with Blackwell's sufficiency conditions. Let X be some subset of the real numbers to the power L. In other words, an element of X is going to be an L-dimensional vector of real numbers. And let B of X be the space of bounded functions from X to the set of real numbers. With the supremum norm that we discussed before. Let T be a function from B of X to B of X. In other words, Give me a function in B of X, continuous and bounded, and T is going to give us another function from the same space. So let this be an operator with the following properties. An operator is just a function of functions. The first key property is monotonicity. Monotonicity means that for any functions f and g in B of x, the set of bounded functions of x, if f of x is always less than or equal to g of x for all x in x, then t of f of x must also be less than or equal to t of g x. And if this is true also for all x in x. The second property is discounting. Discounting is saying that there is some beta between 0 and 1 such that the following holds. Consider any constant A. So A is just some real number. T of F plus A, the constant of X, is less than or equal to T of F of X plus beta A. This should be true for all F, X, and for all constants A greater than or equal to 0. Then, T is a contraction mapping. We're going to say that it is a contraction mapping with modulus beta. What it means is that it's preserving, I guess, an ordering among functions. If you can order functions, then T preserves that ordering. And in addition, it's shrinking constants. So when you take functions and you apply T to them, you're kind of compactifying the space that's going to be covered by those functions. Now, we're going to actually look at the proof of this theorem because it's fairly straightforward, because I think maybe it helps us understand how it is that contraction mappings work. So before we go into the proof, I want to say that sometimes we will be using some shorthand notation, which is that if f of x is less than or equal to g of x for all values of x, we can rewrite this more simply as just saying that f is less than or equal to g. So, what's the proof? The first thing we can say is that given any x, f of x should be less than or equal to g of x plus the distance between f and g, which remember is the supernorm. And this has to be true for all x, because this thing that we're adding here, which, by the way, is a constant, is a positive number and is at least as large as the difference between these two values, f of x and g of x. As a result, it must be that t of f of x is less than or equal to t of this. Put it in there. And now, remembering that this is a constant, the fact that we have discounting means that in turn, this must be less than or equal to t of gx plus beta times this constant. Now, the same should be true if we write down all of this starting with g. G of x has to be less than or equal to f of x plus the maximum distance between f and g. Now, of course, the maximum distance between f and g is the same as the maximum distance between g and f. So we can write this that way. And by the exact same argument, it must be true that if we apply the operator t to both sides of this, on this side we get t of g of x, and on this side we get t of all of this. Once again, because of discounting, this must be less than or equal to tf of x plus beta times this constant. Now let's rewrite this slightly differently. We have two conditions here. Let's cut out the middle. Take the first one, subtract from both sides this expression. Of course, here that's zero. And here subtract from both sides this expression. Of course, again, this is zero. And what have we shown? We've shown that for all x, this constant is bigger than this minus that. And in addition, for all x, this exact same number is bigger than minus that. Because this is minus this. And since this is true for all x, what have we just shown? We have just shown this is true. And of course, that proves that this is a contraction mapping. Great. So now we've covered Blackwell's sufficient conditions for a contraction mapping. It should be intuitive why this applies to the Bellman operator in many contexts, which then means that the value functions that we're going to talk about that will enable us to do dynamic programming are meaningful objects. So there are just a couple more things that we need to discuss in order to make sure that the mathematical foundations of dynamic programming are set, and then we can start to look at some macroeconomic applications. Look forward to seeing you there.